Thank you for the introduction. Can you hear me in back? Okay. First announcement is that, well, I can ask, how many of you here came here hoping to get readings? Okay, that's everybody, right? People are always interested in that, and I'm happy to do it. So after the more formal part of the lecture, I'm happy to do divination with the I Ching for anybody who wants it as much as time permits. So we will get started. I think the first question might be not only how to read it, but why should one read it?
Excuse me, because we have some Chinese friends here, so I do a very brief translation.
The I Ching is one of the two oldest spiritual texts that have been in continuous use since it was first set down 3,000 years ago, the other one being the Hebrew Old Testament. So it's very ancient, and it's been continuously used for that whole 3,000-year period, which is very amazing. There are plenty of older works, but they now are more the province of scholars or people interested in literature. So it has great longevity. Chinese greatly value longevity. So do I as I get older. And it's worth examining it.
3,000年来，哈，只有《易经》跟那个旧约的《心经》，就是《易经》以来都在应用到现在，只有两本书。
First question is, it's an area of great confusion that we need to straighten out at the beginning. How do you say the name of this book? Most people look at the I Ching spelling and say I Ching. That's the Chinese are laughing, right?
Yes. Yes.
But that's the old-fashioned romanization. It's really not very accurate. And now the pinyin official in the PRC and in widespread use, it's more like I Ching. Another term is Zhou Yi. This was written during the Zhou Dynasty, which was 1046 to 771 BC. And so the word Zhou Yi generally refers to the very earliest meanings of the text, which is one thing I'm going to be talking about. Chinese often use Zhou Yi to refer to the whole thing. Yi means change. In modern Chinese, it means easy. And Ching means a classic or scripture. So basically the classic or the book of changes. Older books have all sorts of other ways of spelling it that are, some of which are rather bizarre. How many people have seen this book? A lot. This is what sort of put the I Ching on the map outside of China. The earlier translations were either very inaccurate or very, very hard to read. And so when I tell people I work on I Ching and then I have to say I Ching, and I show them the cover, then they kind of know what I'm talking about. This first came out in 1950. It's published by Princeton. It sold 2 million copies, which is a real record for this kind of relatively esoteric book. And this is the most recent translation, and it is involved in restoring the ancient meanings because the other ones were modified and reinterpreted over and over again during 3 millennia. And it's also much clearer and easier to understand. It has a line-by-line commentary. And coincidentally, it was written by me. Another coincidence, if anyone wants to buy it, it's right here waiting for you.
I have to say one thing. I did the illustration of the cover art. It's by me, and I have my... that's my husband, by the way, and his wife. And my illustration and my calligraphy inside. 这个最新翻译的已经 easier to read, 比较容易看得明白。
This is the earliest manuscript we have, about 300 BC. It's in the possession of the Shanghai Museum. It was bought from tomb robbers. And so a book, when it was written, is a lot different physically than what we're used to. And I think it's important to realize that. This is hexagram number 49, which is well. You can see the hexagram on the top. Is that clear to everybody? But the broken lines are done like that, sort of like the letter, like the word ba for 8. And notice there's no number. The numbering of the hexagrams is something we all use now, but it's a Western addition to it. These were bound together on leather thongs. Supposedly Confucius read so many times he wore out 3 pairs of three sets of thongs. But also means it can get very mixed up, right? You get a bound book, it's in a certain order, and that's the order. In this one, you can mix them up, and it's more difficult. These things were all soaking wet and wadded together in a big lump of mud, and it took Chinese epigraphers, paleographers, more than a year to separate them. So it is a masterpiece of patience. Only Chinese and maybe Japanese have this patience, right? Us Americans, we can only aspire to it. And it's also in an older script, but when we read it, someone has transcribed it into the contemporary Chinese script, so we're not actually reading quite the same things. I think the number of people outside of China who can read this script maybe is 10. Not a lot. I rely on the transcriptions.
When did the museum acquire it?
Shanghai
70s. It was bought on the antiquities market in Hong Kong, and people donated money to the Shanghai Museum to buy it. And I think there's a little money that passed around unofficially about the whole thing.
Right. How much did it sell for?
They won't tell you. I'm sure that it was a huge, I mean, this is one of the great treasures of Chinese history, I'm sure.
That's curious.
I would have paid a lot for it. It's a traditional history of the I Ching, which is like this, 10,000 years ago, which in Chinese just means a long time ago. Fu Shi is a mythical character, saw a magic square in a tortoise on the river. This is Fu Shi wearing an animal skin, and this is a turtle with the trigrams on it. And since then, as you can see, there's a turtle with the eight trigrams. But in the original form of the myth, it has the Lo Shu magic square, which is something where all the lines add up to the same amount. It's associated with the I Ching, but not so much in common with it. So one sees occasionally pictures of Fu Shi here, and many sort of turtle motifs or tortoise motifs. There's a great difference in style between the Western Zhou version and what started in the Warring States period and so-called Confucian influence changed a lot of the meanings around to things that are more acceptable and have more kind of moral and philosophical ideas. The early ones are just simple divination responses. Now, with the scriptural text, we don't say the early meanings are the real meanings. What we say is that the earliest ones, and then as people use it in their own spiritual practice, it gets reinterpreted. The same thing happens with the Judeo-Christian Bible and other sorts of texts like that. This is a famous statement from one of the commentaries in the I Ching. When Fu Shi ruled the world, he looked up and observed the figures in heaven, looked down and saw the model forms under heaven. Hence he devised the eight trigrams to classify the natures of the myriad beings. In other words, it became a model for the whole universe and how the universe worked together. And that's why you could use it for divination. It would tell you how circumstances affecting you. These are some pictures of the characters. The one on over here is Fu Shi again. It's a Song or Qing painting. You can see the little turtle here. This kind of a Zen style painting of Fu Shi.
Fu Shi.
This is
Wen Wang, King Wen.
Wen Wang. Chinese know who Wen Wang is?
All Chinese.
It means literary king, and he's one of the founders of it. A more modern picture of him and Zhou Gong, the Duke of Zhou, on the end. The myth is that King Wen and the Duke of Zhou wrote the line texts. But this sort of thing has all sorts of associations that didn't exist in the era I'm going to be talking about. It's interesting, it's important, but the kind of movement in modern scholarship is to trace it back to as close to its origins as we can get. Now, how many of you have tried reading the changes? Ask in Chinese too. How many found it easy to understand? Who tried to read it? Nobody?
What?
How many found it easy to understand it? Okay. One of the things is we all approach a book with certain preconceptions, right? I mean, that's why I showed you the bamboo strips. It didn't look anything like we would, read on the airplane or something of that sort. So you have to kind of try to set aside anything you expect a book to be. Kind of have an open mind and let it be what it is. There is no author. It's collected together from various oral sources. There are bits of song, historical anecdotes, proverbs, cliches, all sorts of things that somehow people gathered together and put in this book and organized it around the hexagrams. It really more resembles a dictionary than it does, or an encyclopedia than it does a nonfiction book. And nobody would have then opened at page one and read it and kept going through. It's not a narrative. You can't read it that way. It just becomes overwhelming. It's divided into chapters so that you can find the divination response. But it's mostly a collection of phrases. So the unit of meaning is a phrase. And there may be two phrases in the same line that don't necessarily seem to go together. I'll give you some examples of that. And usually when you divine with it, you might get one or two lines. You don't necessarily get the whole chapter. And in fact, some of the lines contradict each other. The earliest description we have of its use actually is many centuries later. So we were inferring what it was like originally, but unfortunately we don't have contemporaneous records.
The use of divination, right?
Yeah. First thing to understand is it has four separate sections. They're put together, but they don't necessarily seem to go together thematically. In other words, you don't understand necessarily why the two lines are together in that chapter. The components are the hexagrams, which I think everybody has seen. And there's what's referred to in translations as a title, but it isn't always clear how it relates to the lines, so it's actually a tag. In other words, it's just a word that you can use to identify which section you're talking about. There's an initial statement that tends to be called the hexagram text or judgment text, and for many years I didn't understand the line text. I thought, well, I'll read the summary and that'll make it clear to me. But it's not necessarily a summary of what goes there. So the scholars believe that these four elements came from different sources and they were compiled together. That, in general, is how very early books are put together, whether it's the Odyssey and the Iliad or Plato or whatever. And then there are six so-called line texts, which are kind of the meat of the whole thing. I shouldn't say that being a vegetarian, but don't worry about the Chinese unless you're Chinese, okay? Here is the first element, which is a diagram. And there's the title Qian, which is an unusual word in Chinese. It's usually thought to mean heaven. Heaven in the sense of the universe beyond you, not necessarily where you go if you're good. And the hexagram statement, which is Yuan Li Heng Yin. And that, I'll show you the translation of it shortly. This is a famous phrase in Chinese. You find it all the time, just like the one about seeing the signs in heaven and the signs of earth. He continued to be influential 3,000 years later. And some of them, I don't have the lines on my slides.
It's the opening of a lot of hexagrams, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I will do this with you in English, okay? Don't panic. The hexagrams are thought to be the earliest element. There's something a little like hexagrams on some Neolithic pre-literate ceramics. But this is all very speculative. We don't really have anything that shows the whole system until that manuscript from 3000. But the version we all use is older than, 300 is older than that. The yin-yang, which everybody knows about, is actually a later concept. It wasn't in the original one. The red from the bottom to the top. So line number one is the bottom and so on. Odd numbers are associated with yang and even ones with yin. And often it has a structure, it may be a process. you know, the first step and so on, or it may refer to social hierarchy, with higher up you go, the more powerful the people are. They're in an array, they're all of the possible combinations of the six lines. The four kinds of lines. This kind of breaks it down. You see the bottom line is line one, and these have certain meanings. For example, line five, which is a young line, represents a powerful official. And the fourth line is close to the official, but actually very dangerous, because people in those days were somewhat irritable, and they decided they were anointed somebody for sighing or something like that. They could be executed in extremely unpleasant ways. So it's a recurrent theme throughout Chinese writing of being near the center of power. It has its dangers. I think we have something like that in the U.S. now, but I can't quite figure out what's going on. And the I Ching hasn't solved that for me. The trigrams later, actually the hexagrams came first, and then they were broken up into two halves of three lines each, and each of these had associations. And one of the reading systems involved the trigrams. I'm not going to go into a lot with the associations, but you see that a lot. Whenever I tell someone who's Chinese that I'm interested in this, they always say, well, which school do you belong to, Xiang Shu or Yi Li? These are two different ways of interpreting it, and there's still a kind of a division between these among Chinese. The first one looks mainly at the hexagrams and kind of numerical things they calculate from the hexagrams. It has a lot of metaphysical ideas which actually aren't in the early text. Yi Li is, it has some analysis of the diagrams, but it's mostly analyzing the texts. And the texts and the diagrams, people find a way to connect them, but it's not always obvious what the diagram has to do with the text part. So scholars, and generally even people use it in the West, tend not to divide themselves up in these two groups. But in China, everybody asks me that. Another way to look at how you read the book, from a scholarly point of view, you look at different periods of time when it was read and understood very differently, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, if we look at the Catholic Church 1,000 years ago, it had, you know, some consistency of doctrine, obviously, but there were also differences. These are particularly important times, originated in the Western Zhou. Wang Bi sort of returned things to the text. And Zhu Xi is a very famous philosopher in China who... The other one, which I lost from my slide, is what's called the Doubting Antiquity Movement. So movement in the early 19th century, after the emperor's system was ended in 1911. And their approach is, I feel I'm in the sort of lineage of that approach. And again, it's looking at removing later meanings and going back to the origin. Another paradox with it, which one has to keep in mind, the change associated with the 60s counterculture. That's when astrology became a fad and all of these sort of things that were rejected, then people start to be interested in them. So it sort of has a dissenting kind of point of view from supposed science. In China, however, it's been very orthodox. People see it as a way to reinforce their morality and improve themselves. Improving themselves meaning more virtuous, upright people. Who knows about Jung? Good. He is the most influential modern interpreter of the I Ching, and his foreword to the famous Wilhelm Bain's translation I showed you at the very beginning. Is the way people usually interpret it, that is in terms of psychology. 3,000 years ago, they weren't talking about neuroses or OCD or things like that. So it's a very different way of thinking. He invented this concept of synchronicity. Have most of you heard of this also? It's a little bit murky concept. It's things that are not causally related but come together, and there's some meaning, reason why they come together. Okay. So sometimes he talks about it more as psychological. You know, your mind makes these special connections. But in other more private writings, he tends to have some sort of supernatural thing. He kind of straddles the fence between these things. Let's talk about how one does readings, and then I'll give you examples, and then I'll do actual readings. This is how I do it. I like someone to say what area of life they're interested in, not too specific a question. So, there are various ways of picking hexagrams. I like the bead method that you'll see. You can do it by numbers.
You
look at a license plate, and then you do a calculation, and that will give you a trigram, and you can do two trigrams that way. People who are real fans of the I Ching know how to do those things. And you find it in the book. You explain what the book says, and then there's interaction between people.
And
there's a way of converting. The hexagram usually is your somewhat immediate situation. Remember, the book is about change, so when you get a divination result, not necessarily going to be the rest of your life the way, say, it would be in astrology. I can give you an example. When I gave a similar talk some years ago, people came up for readings. There's one young Chinese woman, and she said, you know, I have an important decision. So the line that I get, you know, just picking the random, is not favorable to cross the great water. And she says, that's interesting because my boyfriend wants me to move to China and I don't want to move there. So that's one of the kind of experiences that everyone has who uses it, that somehow it's right and you don't know how it's right. I didn't pick that line. And at first I thought it might be discouraging to her, and I don't know what she decided to do. I certainly not tell her, well, don't move to China, but it gives people a perspective and sort of validates what their feelings are.
Can I tell you something?
This is somewhat, did a translation about 20 years ago that's pretty good, but he feels the best way to understand it is to use it for divination, and I absolutely agree with that. I mean, not to boast, but the reason I think I was able to do a clearer translation than some people who are just academics and don't want to do divination is that you actually use it and get somehow it takes on meaning. He says he thinks it works, but he'd rather make decisions for himself than with the I Ching. It seems to me a reasonable point of view. He's not debunking any superstition. He doesn't use it so much for himself, but that doesn't mean somebody else might not. Now I'm going to take some sections. This is my translation with the Chinese text. This is the first four, Yuan Heng Li Jen, are translated as virtues later, but they actually are is a just a phrase that you use to initiate the divination, like alert the gods or whoever. What about hidden dragon, do not act? Who has an idea what that means?
Most people know about this race, right? Chinese specific, hidden dragon.
Well, this is where you have to kind of figure out kind of his symbolism. Dragons represent energy. My reading of this, which I think is probably the old reading too, is the forces acting on you are not obvious now. You know, what's going to determine what happens for you at this time is not obvious, so you just don't do anything. You wait until things clarify themselves. Dragon is seen in the field. You can see what's going on and have better confidence about it. And then it soars in heaven. This might mean a dragon representing a high official that you need to meet with. The overbearing dragon will have remorse. I was amused about that because dragons pretty much seem overbearing to me in my very limited experience. You don't think of the humble dragon so much. But I think what it means, I mean, the reader might be the dragon. It means that if you overdo it, then you'll have some trouble. This flight of dragons without heads sounds very ominous. But Edward Shaughnessy is probably the lead Western scholar of the I Ching, figured out that this is actually talking about constellations referred to as dragons, and sometime during the year, what's called the head of the dragon is cut off. So it's more of an astrological sort of thing. And this is the well, one that I showed you before.
The 48 卦, right?
Yeah.
第48卦,一个井.
Can change the city, cannot change the well. The idea here would be that if you're moving, what sustains life may not be able to move with you, so you need to be very careful about this. And no loss, no gain, kind of a neutral thing.
And
the well being dried up or the well being muddy, this indicates some kind of infertility or lack of support, you know, that you don't have resources that you can rely on for your survival. So it's a warning of a dangerous situation. The I Ching in general has been thought of as optimistic. This might be very useful if you were thinking of moving and actually you hadn't made plans. Years ago, I had a patient who, when I was in Cleveland, decided she wanted to be a teacher in San Francisco, so she sold everything, moved there, and discovered they weren't hiring teachers at all at that time. So these warnings are just as useful as the more cheerful ones. Second hexagram. Blood sacrifice was widespread in the ancient world, including in China. So it says, begin the offering. It means to sacrifice a female horse to do the divination. I don't recommend that now. Now, interesting, Longbi, I pointed out to you, is almost 2,000 years ago, took this, interpreted differently, as a sign that, females should be submissive and passive. That's not what it means. This sort of sexist thing, you don't really find so much in the I Ching. I'm not saying it was an ideal situation for women, but it's an example of how something is distorted that actually doesn't mean at all what people wanted it to mean. First loss, attaining a master. In that kind of ancient society, if you don't have a powerful person who's kind of your sponsor, you're in bad trouble. The west and south, northeast, there are a lot of things about directions, and some directions are lucky to go in. I had a palm reading in a market in Taiwan, and he said it wasn't good for me to travel. Well, I love to travel. And he said, okay, well, you can go east, but not west. So I went what's west from here to India, and then I got sicker than I've ever been in my life, so I should have paid attention. Tread on frost, soon ice will come. This is a proverb. You find the early stage of something, and then it's going to get more extreme. I don't have it in this set. There's one proverb, I was talking to Ming Mei about it, from 3,000 years ago, and it's still common in Chinese. Amongst Chinese, and we actually have a little lucky poster on our door, which has almost the same phrase in it. So you wonder how much can be transmitted orally. This goes back 3,000 years. Holding the mouth of jade tablet is probably part of a ritual with the king. Tying in a sack avoids blame. I think it's if you keep things under control, then you're less likely to get into trouble. What about dragons in the wilderness? Their blood is black and yellow. Who has an idea what this means? If you do, tell me, because no one else has figured it out so far.
Yellow dragon.
Sounds like Trump.
It's easy to make up in meaning, but you know what? This is sort of a interesting thing. If you know something about the ancient Chinese culture, they're driving horses. It's those no bandits invading, but a wedding. There was a tradition of bride stealing. The men in, young men in a village decided they need wives. They'd raid another village and take them. So there was not much. But that got changed, so it was a mock bride abduction. In other words, the marriage had been arranged. Doesn't mean they ever met each other. And then they'd go in and like pretend that they were doing the abduction. And that's what it's referring to. What it means in divination is what looks bad is actually a happy occasion. You just don't quite know what's going on, but it will end up well. And deer coming out into the midst of the forest. Hunting was a big thing then. It was about the only entertainment.
What is the only thing?
Hunting.
Oh, hunting. This is 古代打猎其中一个娱乐，重要的一个娱乐。
So if a deer comes out of the forest, there's somebody with a bow and arrow is going to kill them. So this is basically a warning to not get in an exposed position. A lot of situations where that can happen. Last one, collecting the fatty meat. When there was a ritual, an animal was killed, then it would be cut up and the better pieces would go to the people of higher rank.
So,
not so different nowadays. But it also tells another thing about historical nutrition. Fat has the most calories, right? More than protein and carbohydrate. And so in a situation where there may be caloric deprivation, you want the fat because you need the calories to maintain your body, grow properly, and so on. A couple of interesting things here. Basically, the student or the junior person asks you the same question over and over. People get very annoyed, and I certainly do that in my practice. But it also refers to the I Ching. You're not supposed to ask the same question over and over because it's often people think of the I Ching like it's a person. It's annoying. They take this out of the later translations, but they're basically recommending beating the students.
Okay.
Famous writer George Orwell said that they used to, in the English so-called public schools, which are really private, everyone had to learn Latin and they would beat the kids. And George Orwell said that no one can learn Latin unless they're beaten. And I took 2 years of it in college, I wasn't beaten and I didn't learn it.
I'm not
complaining, okay? Really, the idea that children should not be physically punished is pretty recent, right? 50 years maybe? Not that long. This is one of the rare juicy passages. The word gu can mean poison or spoiled food. The elements of the character are worms in a bowl. But it also can refer to improper sexual activity. Usually, they had no concept like we do of sexually transmitted diseases. Usually it was having too much sex. The man having too much sex caused lots of problems. And an earthquake or something like that might be blamed on the emperor having too much sex. Emperors had well over 100 wives. And supposedly, each of his concubines was entitled to have sexual intercourse every 5 days. So I'm still trying to do the math on how this guy worked that out. But there's also a reference here to filial piety, which is a prime Chinese virtue, and not much about it in earlier writings. The father did some misbehaving and causes difficulty. With the mother, you shouldn't be too strict. It's showing respect for the mother. And you can try to undo the harm that the father has caused. So it's basically saying the parents might be at fault, but you try to still deal with them in a nice way.
就是父母有什么做得不好，做子女的要不要太。How do you undo the illness caused by the father?
What is it?
It says down there.
Yeah.
How do you do that?
The previous line.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, at the bottom there.
Yeah.
You know, you won't be praised, but how do you do that?
This is the nature of the text. It doesn't give you a lot of details. You sort of think there's a situation where it was asked as a question and it might have had specific circumstances, but we don't know that. But the basic idea is that your parents may have done things that are wrong, but you should still treat them well. I mean, that's... This is an example of how you interpret hexagrams separate from the text. The first one is already across, the task is completed. Crossing a river is kind of the metaphor for this. That's because all the lines are in the so-called correct positions. There's a yang line with an odd number and a yin line with a yin position. So this is, they're in order the way they should be. Society's in order. However, it's not a particularly favorable hexagram. The next one is the complete inverse. In other words, all the lines are in the wrong position. But that's dynamic because it'll move toward eventually being in the right position, and so lots of things will be happening rather than everything going on being static.
到对的方向走过去，大概是这样。Now,
in doing readings,
在起卦的时候,
I think it, you know, there's it's a thing that people need to do responsibly. People can take it very, very seriously. It has a big impact on people, not everybody and not always, but it can. So, just as I said, I told this young woman that it said not favorable to cross a great water. I certainly wouldn't say you shouldn't marry this guy or you should marry him or anything like that. You just give her a little food for thought. You give it perspective, as I said. Not telling me what to do, but a way of looking at the situation. And you don't want to say anything that's frightening. A lot of times in my experience, some fairly deep emotional issues come out that people didn't think would come out. It just somehow arises. And as a reminder to be, feel some humility about it, even Confucius himself was right only 70% of the time. At least that's the legend. I'm going to spend about 5 minutes showing some patterns of it in popular culture, both East and West. There are many such diagrams or people who spend their lives trying to figure out the correct ordering of the hexagrams, which I think is a lost cause. And people analyze it mathematically. I have a book that's filled with these diagrams. I don't understand them. But for people with a certain kind of mental style, they find this, they get really caught up in this. This is shows it being related to other sorts of things. Here it's connected with the hand and also with parts of the body. Each of the trigrams refers to a certain body part. And again, there are many systems like this. This is a way to figure out a trigram by rotating around your palm. This book is about, it's something like 800 pages. And it's filled with diagrams like this. I mean, literally hundreds of them. I don't know even with a computer how you could do that. But this is the kind of fascination people get with this system. It seems to explain a lot of things, and you feel, well, if I only had the key, I could figure it out and then understand everything in life. I haven't been able to do that. I doubt that anybody does, but a huge amount of human effort goes into this sort of thing. This is the ultimate in the modern world. This is supposedly mathematical formulas to discover the correct order. The person who invented it works in information technology at UC Berkeley. Again, it's a sort of fascination about it, but I'm not sure that it's time well spent. You see these mirrors in every little shop in Chinatown. The bagua is for good luck. That's the eight trigrams. And the mirror is to reflect away evil spirits. So if you have any issues with that, they're pretty cheap.
No, some people, let's say they live across from the cemetery, that kind of thing, then you have to put the this because you reflect all the bad energy back to that person or that location.
This is a commemorative stamp printed in Macau. It's just yet another example of how the I Ching is used for imagery in popular art forms. Medallion. Tarot cards. They're not really tarot, but they look like that. And a piece by John Cage I was not able to put on my slides, which called Music of Changes is kind of amelodic and random notes, and perhaps it has something profound to say about it. I missed it.
I met him personally, John Cage, at a music festival, and I heard that piece.
But what's interesting about that is how adaptable the book has been. That's one reason it survived for 3,000 years. You can fit it into, you know, contemporary atonal music. You can fit it into decorating your postage stamps, almost anything, keeping away evil spirits, anything you want. This is the last hexagram, and it means things are not yet complete.
And
that applies to the story of the I Ching is not yet complete. I'm sure there'll be more and more ways of reading it and using it in art and so on. So it's an ongoing thing. Okay, that's the end of the talk. Mm-hmm.